check the mic and make sure it sound right, boys.
Hello and welcome back to the new episode of Arrow. And today we have a guest who is an expert or a researcher from a topic who is one of my favorite topics, as you can see here. And we will talk about everything what we can think of to ask him, because in my life I have never got any chance to talk to an actual astrophysicist. It's always through YouTube or Spotify or something. But before that, please like, share, and subscribe. We are posting and publishing a video every Sunday, sometimes in between the week. And just spread the channel. We are building an ecosystem here where we want to learn from the experts and get motivated. And yeah, please do it. share our channel and like and subscribe. We are working very hard. And yeah, we have a great guest lineup, and let's see. Okay, so Krishna, welcome to the Arrow, and we are so happy to have you. As I was telling before this, also that it's an honor that an actual astrophysicist is already agreeing to come to our podcast today. So. We start from you only. Tell our viewers about you.
Yeah. First of all, it's my pleasure to be on your channel. So I'm, like you said, I'm not an. I would say I'm not an expert in astrophysics, because astrophysics is a bigger branch. I have knowledge on much narrower part of it, mainly on the sun, which is which deals about solar physics. We will perhaps talk about in detail much later about it. So about myself, so I did my PhD in solar physics. So I did my, before that I did master's in space physics. So I went through the usual route, or the less taken route perhaps in India currently, because most of them are engineers anyway. So after intermediate, I did my bachelor's, and then in bachelor's of science, so BSc, and then after that I did master's in space physics in Andhra University in Vizag. So, and after that I moved to Bangalore to do my PhD in solar physics in an institute called Indian Institute of Astrophysics. Maybe most people might be aware of Indian Institute of Technologies, but there is an Indian Institute of Astrophysics in Bangalore. So where I did my PhD from in solar physics. And after that, I moved to Belfast in Northern Ireland, which comes under UK, where I did a postdoctoral fellowship position for 5 years before moving to Belgium, where I'm a fellowship holder doing again the research on solar physics. So I'm currently in Belgium holding this fellowship, continuing my research on solar physics.
Yeah. So tell me, how do you get interested in astrophysics particularly? Because I know and I remember when I was getting into a bachelor's degree, I was thinking, should I take mechanical engineering? It was engineering, first of all. I mean, middle class people, engineering, it's a stamp on our back since childhood. So I was thinking mechanical, computer, electrical. How do you get into astrophysics?
Well, yes, like you say, engineering is still a big craze in India. That's perhaps the safe bet to, I wouldn't say maybe all streams to earn big bucks, but definitely a safe bet to get a job for sure. So my career has not been like entirely a planned one. Like I dreamt of being an astrophysicist, and so I became an astrophysicist or something like that. My education, I mean, I took the path that was available to me whenever I'm about to take the next stage. So like after 10th standard, I would say I had an option to, for example, to take up a polytechnic polytechnic coaching and then get usual, I think it's a diploma. Once you take the polytechnic, you get a diploma in some branch, and then after that, it is the shortest way to get a job. I think after 3 years of it, you get a job or something like that. So I had a, I remember I got a good rank to get that seat in one of the colleges, but then somehow I opted for doing intermediate. So intermediate education or pre-university education. So once that pre-university education was done, which was in science stream, then I did my bachelor's. Again, because of opportunity, not because of like I wanted to do it. It's just that after we had a college in our hometown where this bachelor's was available at nearly less cost or nearly cheap, nearly no cost. So there, I did my bachelor's in a government degree college in my hometown. So after that, I got a seat in Andhra University. So, I mean, my teachers, throughout my journey, my teachers were, some of my teachers were motivators in the sense that they directed me a bit to go to this stream or that stream. So in my bachelor's, for example, there were teachers who liked me and then they say sort of like, you should do master's, you should do this master's of science or something like that. Some of my teachers from pre-university, they even asked me to take this particular subject of space science. I had literally no clue what space science is then. But the only thing is there are very few seats in Andhra University teaching space science. That is the only information I had. Hardly 10 seats in Andhra University we had. And then the obviously the entire state is competing for it. And they also have a quota of 50% for people coming from other states. So I got the seat luckily and I placed in space science. And then I got introduced to astrophysics through a research project I did during my master's in Bangalore. So I got, I suddenly saw, for example, an advertisement in one of our notice boards in my university that there is a research project available, project position available in Bangalore. So I thought, okay, why not? Let us take up this. Again, I had no clue about astrophysics then. So despite doing master's in space science, I mean, I might know a bit, but not really much clue about why this is a niche stream or why this is better for me or something like that. So I got that position again, and then I came to Bangalore to do that research project. It was only for a few months, 2 months or 3 months. During which I was really fascinated by astrophysics. What I attended several seminars, obviously, when I was in this institute, Indian Institute of Astrophysics, there were several seminars on astrophysics. And I was really fascinated by what breadth astrophysics covers. So I was very much fascinated by it. That's how I came into astrophysics.
Were you always a good student, or was it like, once you got interested in something, then you became a good student, or should I say good learner, not a student?
Yes, we are forever students, but during my, I would say, very young ages, perhaps lower than maybe third or fourth standard, I wasn't really a good student. I was like bottom of my class. There were 35 students, then I would get perhaps the 35th rank or something like that. So I was not, but then there was a transition. I don't know, maybe some inspiring words from my seniors or my teachers. There was a transition. There was a sudden transition. In fact, like after a few years, I became topper of my class or something like that. So there was a sudden transition. So I was a decent student, like I would say throughout my career or throughout my education, I was a decent to good student.
I see. Because when I was a kid, I was a good student or a good learner, whatever you can say. But in between, I lost my way or something. And mm-hmm. after that, I again woke up somehow. And mm-hmm. at that time, I came to know that I see everybody wakes up at a certain point of time in their life. Mm-hmm. And I was and perhaps you're also lucky that you also woke up at the right, correct time, because some people got to get very late. And what did your family say? Because I don't know if your family knows about astrophysics as a stream for higher studies to get a job, because we are Indians and every study or every course or every degree which we do is always for a job. So what was your family's reaction and how did they take it?
Well, my parents are not really very much educated. They did not, they dropped out of school very early and they did not really go to, my mom didn't go to school. My father dropped out of like maybe just after a few years, 2 or 3 years, he did not go to school at all. So they are not very educated. They don't know about astrophysics. I myself didn't know about astrophysics until my master's. So I wouldn't expect them to know. But like I said, throughout my career, it's all decided by the opportunities I have and what is the best at that point of time for me. So obviously I want a job ultimately, but then from the background we had, I felt that time any job would be fine for us. Like ultimately whatever job we get, any job would be, we will do better than whatever current situation is. That it was like that. So I was not aiming too much for the jobs, but my parents knew that I'm doing good at education. So people were encouraging us, from our school principals to class teachers to others, were encouraging us that your kid is doing good, so let him study, something like that. So obviously I don't think anybody would encourage people to study until PhD or something like that, because people consider it is too late in your career or in your age to keep on studying. But then, like you said, it's all learning. So we are all learners. So it's learning something new thing. And if it is exciting for you, please go ahead.
Yeah. I see. You said that your parents were not too much literate. So how was it for you? Did you always study by yourself? Because normally sometimes parents help. So who helped you during your life to study? Was it your friends? Because I know Abhimanyu taught us everything in engineering. If he was not there, we would have failed. Mm-hmm. So who was there for you?
I would say it's not my parents, obviously, who were teaching me during schooling or afterwards, but mainly I would say the class teachers who liked me. So they were teaching me, and I was the topper of the class most of the time. So it's not that some of my friends who were teaching me, but most of the times it is class teachers. And then I was also fascinated or excited by things I understand. Like I used to study myself at home as well, and then I understand things, and whenever I understand a physical concept, I was far more excited when I was young than I am now. But it was really exciting to understand physics, especially for me. So
I see.
Great. Good to hear your inspiring journey. And mm-hmm. I mean, as you said that astrophysics is not much hard topics and not much popular also, there are many regions why people are not choosing, at least particularly in India, because we look for the job, certain sense of security. Mm-hmm. So that's great, but still you have just went ahead with those things, whatever opportunity you got, and you are excelling on that. So good to hear that. So let's we'll get into the topic directly now. Mm-hmm. So let us understand what is astrophysics. I mean, what sort of study is being done under this topic, and what are the associated discipline in this? How vast is this?
Yes. So astrophysics is quite vast, both literally in the sense that astrophysics deals with physics of any celestial body. So which means celestial in terms of any body in the sky, like including our own Earth. So any body in the universe, like it is about the science of astronomical bodies. So astrophysics deals with everything. So among it, like there are other sort of branches, not branches, but related fields, like people often use them synonymously, like astronomy. So astronomy is mainly about, it's perhaps even older than astrophysics, because astronomy is mainly about observations, like just about looking at sky and then seeing, okay, this object is this, this is a star, or this is a constellation, or this is the motion of this, or the position of this, or the brightness of a star, or something like that. So astronomy is more about measurement of these celestial bodies. Whereas astrophysics is trying to model it and trying to obtain the physics of it, trying to understand the physics of it, astrophysics is.
Okay, great. And then we have heard of the, this terminology called cosmology. So yeah. Is that same like astrophysics and something related to astronomy? Are these three terms the same?
Yes. So there are minor distinctions between astronomy and astrophysics. Like I said, astronomy is more into observations, like looking at something in the sky and then saying this. Astrophysics is more into finding the, like, the physics behind it. Cosmology is more in terms of larger scales, like even larger scales, universe scales. So cosmology deals with, like, for example, how the universe formed, how the universe is evolving, or where we are going, something like that. Cosmology deals with that. So of course there are other branches you can call, something like the if you study the stars, then it is called stellar physics. Or you can say there are people who study galaxies, people who study planetary bodies. So there are other galactic astronomy or planetary sciences or other substreams. Like I study sun, so it is a solar physics or something like this. There are other substreams, but these are all broadly called astrophysics.
And you were using one term called space science. So what is it?
Yes, it's interesting. So the space science can be even broader, like anything related to space, by going by the word of it. But then mostly the space science refers to our immediate environment of the Earth, like immediate atmosphere of the Earth. And what happens in space for us is just immediate vicinity of the Earth. So we can talk about, for example, the satellites. We can talk about the travel to Moon or Mars or astronauts or something like that. That is, or the atmosphere of the Earth itself, like the, there are several layers in the Earth's atmosphere, troposphere, stratosphere, ionosphere, or so depending on how these layers vary is significant to us as our day-to-day life. So there are several physical effects that are happening within our Earth's atmosphere itself. So the space science mostly deals with our Earth's atmosphere and its vicinity.
I see. As you were saying that you are doing currently PhD and in Belgium. So what is the research topic? What is the topic of which you are researching currently?
Yes. So I actually finished my PhD long back. It's been like maybe 7 years back or 8 years back, I finished my PhD. So after PhD, this is more or less like a job, but still we will be continuing the research. So it is a postdoctoral position, postdoctoral in the sense that it is after PhD. So
you are a scientist, a research scientist.
Yes. Yeah, you can call research scientist is probably an appropriate word. This is just a position name, postdoctoral position, but research scientist can be an appropriate word. So what I do currently, so to tell you that, so I should tell a bit about sun. So there are several interesting problems on sun. I mean, this we can talk about hours, like why we study sun or what is interesting about sun. We see why should we study sun or several things we can talk about for hours. But then to get close to my research topic, I would introduce you to some problem called coronal heating problem. So corona is the outer atmosphere of the sun. Okay. So in several decades ago, we came to know that the outer atmosphere of the sun is pretty hot. Hot as in like with temperatures of millions of Kelvin, millions of degrees. It doesn't matter when degrees or Kelvin when the temperature is so high. So it is millions of Kelvin hot, the outer atmosphere. But the problem is that the main energy in the sun comes from the core of the sun, where the temperature is again millions of Kelvin, but the temperature gradually drops as you move from the center of the sun towards the surface of the sun. On the surface of the sun, it's the temperature is about 5,000 degrees. And from there, again, the temperature, when you move into the atmosphere of the sun, the temperature again goes up from 5,000 degrees to millions of Kelvin again. So it's as if like you have a source of heat or energy, like a flame or a bonfire or something, and then you're moving away from it. So initially you're getting cooler and you're feeling cooler and cooler as you move away from the bonfire. But then at some point you felt the coldest, and after that, beyond you're moving, then you're again feeling hotter and hotter. So why is it that? Maybe perhaps you're moving to some other bonfire, or maybe there is some other source of energy, right? So obviously here we are not moving closer to another star or another source of energy. So what is the source of energy that is making this the atmosphere much hotter than the surface of the sun? This is called a coronal heating problem that's been there since several decades, like 1940s or something. It was initially discovered and still we are researching it. So that's, at the outset, you can see the physical concept, right? So you can see that, okay, I'm moving from a heat source and I'm still feeling hot. Why is it that? So it's counterintuitive and it's against the laws of physics. So that's something research has been going on for several decades. We have some idea, but that's perhaps too technical to discuss.
Yeah, yeah, but if you can share your idea, if it is not under any secret, what is that idea?
No, it's not really a secret. Like when I say we have some idea, it's not just my idea. It's been, like I said, it's been researched for several decades, from 1940s to several decades. So we know that, to say how is this getting heated, you should know how the surface of the sun is. So the sun, of course, is a gaseous ball. So at the surface, if you look closely at the surface, I should perhaps put a disclaimer that when I say you look at the sun, you should never look at the sun directly. So you should look at the images of the sun, or you should use some protective glasses or something to look at the sun. So what I'm saying here is that when you look at the images or the surface of the sun, when you get to look it at detail, so you can see that there are bubbly motions like what you see in a pot of boiling water. So there will be bubbly motions. So these are called convective motions, same like in a pot of boiling water. Again, it's very analogous, so that the energy is being transferred from the interior of the sun to the exterior by this bubbling motion, these convective motions. And then the basically a hot parcel of gas comes up and then it releases the heat through radiation, and then it cools down and goes back to the interior of the sun. So these bubbly motions, along with that, there are very concentrated magnetic field patches on the sun, some patches which are called sunspots. So these patches have very concentrated magnetic field of kilogauss. For comparison, on Earth, we have the magnetic field on Earth we have is about half a gauss. So there on the sun, there are patches of magnetic field of the order of kilogauss. So these kilogauss magnetic field fields, because of this constant bubbly motions, these magnetic field gets pushed against each other. And then they create, these magnetic field motions can create various physical processes, like it can generate waves that propagate along the magnetic fields, or it can put the fields against each other, they snap against each other, and then they release enormous amount of energy. So this energy is what is powering the solar atmosphere to heat up to millions of Kelvin. That's the rough idea. But obviously we are investigating much finer details, but that's the rough idea of what is being investigated currently.
I just have got a stupid question. The question is that since sun is releasing its energy in the form of light and heat, so is it losing its weight? And if it is losing its weight, is the gravity of all the 9 planets or 8 planets right now is reducing gradually, and one day it will be lost?
Oh yes, you're absolutely correct. So it is losing its weight, it is losing its mass, but very, very, by very, very tiny fraction. So sun also has so-called, there is a constant stream of particles coming out of the sun, so which we call as a solar wind. I mean, the term perhaps is intuitive. So you always get a constant stream of particles from all directions of the sun. This is called solar wind. So when these constant stream of particles move away from the sun, obviously it is losing mass, but then that's by very, very tiny, tiny fraction of amount. So it loses mass overall, but it doesn't have such significant impacts to change the gravity, or doesn't have a huge impact basically on the planetary bodies. In short time scales. But I mean, there are much bigger things that will create huge impact in the future than just losing these particles. This constant stream of particles is not going to create huge impact even in the future, because there are bigger events that are going to happen. So rather than this, just because of this constant stream of particles.
I see. And you were talking about solar winds. And what is a sunspot, first of all? And I also have read, Abhimanyu, have shared me all your papers. And I think 99.9% was above my head, because it was in difficult English. And what is sunspot? Because I think it was one of your research topic.
If we dig deeper, sunspots is a bigger area of research in, again, but I work on a small aspect of sunspots. So the sunspots is basically, as the name suggests, spots on the sun. So they are dark spots on the sun. So if you see the sun's images, the surface of the sun in images, you will see sometimes, or most of the times, you will see dark spots here and there on the sun. These dark spots, we came to know, I mean, these were only dark spots several centuries ago. I mean, when they were discovered several centuries ago, they were only dark spots. But now we know much more information than saying that they're just dark spots. The information we have is that those dark spots are patches of concentrated magnetic fields, where like I said, the surface of the sun is have this constant bubbly motion with these convective motions. But then wherever this constant, a big patch of magnetic field, concentrated magnetic field is there, this bubbly motion is inhibited. So naturally, as I said before, this bubbly motion will bring the hot parcel of gas to the surface, and then that releases the radiation to the outside the sun. But then wherever this patch of magnetic field is there, this bubbly motion is inhibited. So there is no hot bubble of gas coming up at that location. So you will not see any radiation, or it will be, I mean, technically speaking, it will be less radiation coming from there. So you will be seeing them as dark compared to the rest of the surface. So they are sunspots, yes.
I already always had a misconception, because I thought these dark spots are so bright that we cannot see it and they become dark, because I have seen that whenever there is a light flashing lightning or something and we take a picture, it comes out very dark. And that's what I always thought, but it's just the other way around.
They are not really bright. I mean, it depends on the wavelength you look at, but still in most of the light it is they're dark. So it's not really dark in the sense that they have less emission overall. But if you come to the outer surface atmosphere of the sun, then the rest of the surface of the sun looks pretty boring. But then wherever these dark spots are there, you will see bright loops. So perhaps that's what you're talking about, but not at the, it has nothing to do with the surface of the sun. On the surface of the sun, it is still, the sunspots are still dark patches in most wavelengths you look at. But if you come to the outer atmosphere, like I said, because these are concentrated fields and there is much activity going on, and then they transfer mass and energy to the outer atmosphere. So in the outer atmosphere, you see them very bright very bright, beautiful, it forms a beautiful magnetic loops. So when you see images of the solar atmosphere in extreme ultraviolet or other wavelengths, you will see very bright loops. These are the these loops are rooted at these dark patches. So those are the only bright aspects if you look in the outer atmosphere, whereas rest of the sun surface will look quiet. But if you look at the exactly at the surface, these patches look dark.
I wish you were Iron Man, because you were doing everything and I just want to visualize it. When you were talking about solar sun's atmosphere, what does it exactly mean? To be more clear, what does it actually constitute of? Because I think sun is made of only one gas, which and the fusion is going on there, and that's why it is releasing so much of heat and energy. Mm-hmm. So am I right?
Yeah. And yeah, you're mostly correct. So first of all, I mean, to coming to the first part of your question, what is solar atmosphere? Just like we have Earth atmosphere, right? So of course, Earth or any planetary body has, I should be careful here. Earth has an atmosphere. So for Earth, the Earth is a solid body. And then the above this, we have the gases, nitrogen or carbon dioxide or several oxygen or several gases we have. These all constitute the surroundings of the Earth, right? The surroundings of the Earth is Earth's atmosphere. Also, these gases are bound by the gravity of the Earth. So this constitutes Earth's atmosphere. Similarly, we have a surface of the sun, even though it is a gaseous ball. So we have a surface of the sun, and beyond that surface, we have some certain gases which are bound by the gravity of the sun, that is solar atmosphere. Now, like you said, coming to the second part of your question, you said most of the sun is just a single element, which is hydrogen. So in fact, most of the universe is just a single element, which is hydrogen. But then at the core of the sun, when this hydrogen fuses, it forms helium. And then you have helium is the next abundant element. But then there are other elements as well, like iron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, or other elements as well, but in trace amounts in the sun. Now, when you come to, I have been speaking more about the gaseous ball or gas or something, but then if you come to the solar atmosphere, the matter is not in the state of gas. So as we know with our physics background that there are four states of matter, solid, liquid, gas, or the common three states of matter on Earth. But then there is fourth state of matter called plasma. So because, like I said before, in the solar atmosphere, the temperatures go up to millions of Kelvin. So at that temperature, the matter exists in a phase called plasma, where it is completely ionized. So which means you have more of protons, electrons, rather than and ions rather than gas.
I see. That's interesting. So one thing which came to my mind is that everybody in this world knows nothing about sun and its working, but they know about solar flares, because everybody knows that if a solar flare occurs, then a big disaster on Earth will occur and the humanity will cease to exist and all our things will go dark and so on. So what is it actually, and how can it do it?
Yeah, so that's a very good question. So people might be mostly aware of solar flares, you're right, mainly because of the impacts it can cause. Not every solar flare will cause an impact, but then there are gigantic flares or which can cause a huge impact on Earth. So they occur rarely, but then they do occur. And then whenever they occur, they can cause huge impacts on Earth. So how can they cause impacts on Earth? Like I said, the surface, the atmosphere of the sun mainly contains these charged particles, whether it is protons, electrons, or ions. These are held by these magnetic fields, which I said like loops, these magnetic loops, which hold them. When they snap against each other, there is some process called reconnection. They reconfigure themselves to a minimum energy state. So when they do that, then they release charged particles into the atmosphere. So there is a constant stream of wind coming from the sun, I said before. But then when these events happen, when these snapping of the field lines or some reconnection events happen, there will be huge explosions on the sun. When these huge explosions happen, a big amount of charged particles compared to the normal solar wind particles, a big amount of charged particles come towards, I mean, they basically travel towards all directions around the sun, but then some of them obviously can come depending on the way the particles are shot at, they can come towards Earth as well. When they come towards Earth, because these are charged particles, now we know that it can cause, these charged particles can cause huge disruption to any electronics, whether it is, for example, it is there in, if you have satellites, we mostly talk about satellites, astronauts, because we have, thankfully, we have for Earth, we have a protective shield, which is magnetic field. So the Earth has a pretty strong magnetic field to shield these charged particles from coming to the surface of the sun. So they don't basically reach us. But when the storms are very powerful, they can reach to the nearly close to the surface. Then we know that ultimately the electricity, for example, we are getting is basically charged particles moving in metallic wires or something like that, right? So, but if there is another charged particle moving around that wire or near in the vicinity of that wire, that can induce currents. When that currents are induced, because these charged particles are highly energetic, they can induce huge currents in these transmission lines, for example, and then that can for example, disrupt these transformers, which happened earlier in the past, actually. So if the transformers, for example, in a city, in a big city, which is completely dependent on electricity, we are totally dependent on electricity nowadays. And then if the all the transformers in a city are suddenly damaged, then it would take weeks to months, depending on where you are in the world, to repair all those transformers, to restore back the power. And if there is no power, we don't have internet, we don't have, for example, all the banking systems, all the software systems, so it can, perhaps the trading systems, it can create huge losses to the economy. That's on the economy side, but these charged particles can also cause other sort of disruptions to, for example, astronauts, communication, because ultimately all of our communication is dependent on radio waves. And then these radio waves, we are able to communicate, even though Earth is like a globe, we are able to communicate from one part of the world to the one part of the world to the other part of the world, because the radio waves we communicate bounce back and forth between the ionosphere to the Earth's surface. And then they travel, even though it is curved, they travel from one part of the world to the other part of the world by this bouncing back and forth. But imagine the ionosphere, which is reflecting these waves, it is partially absorbing and partially reflecting because of disruptions of these charged particles. So then what happens is, you will hear some communication, but not some, because there will be disruptions in the communication. So these are all, I mean, just perhaps a tip of iceberg, if I could say, so that I'm only saying some of the impacts that it could cause. So it has really vast impacts, especially we are dependent so much on satellites and technology or power or internet or communication these days.
As a research scientist, when you are your specific area of research is actually sun, do you worry about these type of things, that it is a possibility, it is a certain possibility in future, or it is just in the back of your mind and you go on with researching the sun? Because for me, I can start doing my job and I can forget everything. I forget my family when I am at work. So what happens with you?
That's an interesting question. So if, like I said, these events are rare, but they do occur. They happened in the past and they can happen in the future. They can happen anytime. The only thing we could do is by trying to predict them and then try to avoid it somehow. Perhaps if they happen for few hours, maybe perhaps switching off the power transmission lines or something like that to avoid any potential damage because of these events. Perhaps asking the astronauts not to travel during that time or something like that. So we can try to avoid the problems, because it's a natural phenomenon happening. There is nothing we could do to completely avoid it from happening, but we can protect us from by knowing when it will happen or how it will happen. By knowing that, we can protect us from the potential impacts of it. So that's a big part of solar research going on currently. So it's in fact a good thing that we are studying it, because ultimately we can protect the mankind or the human life from these potential impacts of these solar explosions.
You were talking that saying that we can predict. So is there any way that we can predict these solar flares, and if yes, then how?
Yes. So I briefly explained the physics of it, how these eruptions happen. Like you have magnetic loops, these move because of the bubbly motions on the surface, and then these magnetic fields snap against each other, and then suddenly an eruption happens. We know much finer details. The people who do research know much finer details, but then there are certain elements which we are still uncertain of, like when will this eruption happen? At what threshold impact these fields snap, and how much mass will be released, or how fast this eruption is going to arrive at Earth, whether it is arriving at Earth or it is going in some other direction which we don't care about, or something like that. All these things are being modeled for several years, if not decades, or perhaps more than a decade. And more there are computer modelings, computer simulations trying to understand this phenomena by putting in the physics we know so far, and then trying to predict when these will reach at Earth. So thankfully, some of them take a few days to reach, but then that might not be enough in some cases. Some of them can come, or perhaps the most violent of them, unfortunately, come in less than a day, in half a day. But still, in that half a day, whether you can plan to shut down everything or whether you know the potential impact of it, all these are crucial elements that are part of ongoing research.
I see. I get afraid about after hearing that, but it's at the same time quite interesting. It's like, what do you call it? There is some guilty pleasure. It's something like that. I like listening to this, but I'm also afraid of it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, these events are rare, and then we have an Earth's magnetic field which is protecting us. So we should be very rarely they reach up to the surface where we are living. But then, like I said, it's mostly the technological challenge or technological disruptions which we will be having. It could be potentially impacting human life, because ultimately when the... you see, if there is a huge damage to economy because of power disruptions or the banking systems or whatever, or satellites get disrupted, communication, economy, all these are going to affect our day-to-day life, and it can potentially cause damage to human life, day-to-day life. But these events are pretty rare, but we are also trying to predict, and there is also a certain time gap. So I think there is less, I wouldn't say completely, there is nothing to worry about. But at the same time, the only thing, the best we could do is currently to try to understand them, which we are doing right now. So
we were talking about economical losses. Is there some stream of science which is studying the biological effects of these solar flares, or is it close to nothing? But still, it's just solar light.
I'm not an expert in that area, but I'm sure there are certain people studying these biological effects, because you see, ultimately we talk about traveling to moon, traveling to Mars, and then all these space missions and astronauts. And so one of the challenges going to moon or Mars is that you have to go to outer space. And outer space is full of these charged particles moving across. They are, of course, less dense. They are very sparse. But then when they move, if you don't have a protective shield, they move into you. And then these highly charged particles like protons, they can move through your body. And when they move, they can disrupt, for example, your DNA structure, potentially causing cancer and other very hazardous harmful diseases or harmful effects to the astronauts, for example, or any people in space. So, I mean, damage to satellites or these things are different, and then damage to people is also again a big impact when you're, especially when you're planning to travel to other planets or something like this. I actually forgot what exactly you asked. Maybe I'm not sure if I answered your question. No, so.
I was just asking that the biological effects, who is studying it?
Yes, thanks. So yes, there are biological effects, and then I'm sure there are certain people studying it, yes.
Krishnaji, actually, we were talking about the predicting the activity, solar activities. Mm-hmm. So earlier also, like you have mentioned, there are not well-established physics theory where we can predict even the activity which is going on in the sun, basically doesn't follow the physics law. As you explained, the heat on the outer surface is more compared to the near to the core where it. So when we talk about the prediction, and you have told there are certain simulation we established based on some physics law. So how accurate these prediction work, since there is no well-established theory regarding those particular environment? And does did you ever face, or you know, like any prediction has gone wrong from the astrophysicist?
Certainly, certain several predictions have gone wrong. See, one of the beauty or one of the important things about research is that failures are good. Like if a theory fails, that means you are at least excluding a certain theory, and then you're moving on to different theory. So you should definitely have these failures. Like, okay, I'm proposing a theory, but then if you can prove that it is wrong, that is also a good thing. It's not a bad thing. So that is a beautiful side of research. So anyway, so there are certainly several theories failed, and then see, broadly speaking, some of the elements we still don't understand, but then if we put together all the elements which we understand or which we came to know from the research on several decades, we put together, and then there are some people who could predict the arrival of these charged particles within several hours to days, but currently the research is going on to improve that to perhaps within few hours or something like that. So that time scale. So how well we can predict. So this is ongoing research, and there is certainly improvements happening with time. Improvements happening in terms of observing the sun. The better we observe the sun, the better we understand the physics of it, the more we can develop these theoretical models, and then the better we can come close to reality. So.
So when we like talking about the tracking the activities, so I, before you came, I was trying to read little bit about this, and I see that long years back, like thousands years back, so people used to track the activity in the solar activity. So how technologically we advanced, and what technology we use for the tracking these activities basically?
See, there are slightly different things. One thing is these eruptions I was talking about, tracking them, and then when they arrive at Earth, that is a related but a slightly different aspect. Another thing is tracking activity for centuries or at least hundreds of years or decades. So that activity we talk about is the sun has a cycle. If we discussed about sunspots a while before, so if you count, the sunspots represent the strongest of the magnetic field patches on the sun, we discussed before, and these are related to the activity of the sun, because ultimately these magnetic fields snap and eruptions come, and then these are the causes of the major eruptions. So to tell about how active the sun is, we can count, for example, how many spots are there on the sun, right? Because these are the concentrated magnetic field patches. We can count, okay, today there are 100 spots, maybe it is very active. Today there are 10 spots, maybe it is less active. So we can count like that. And that counting has been done for centuries now. And then, the main counting has been done for decades, but then currently there are methods with which we can backtrace the counting of the sunspots to centuries. So with these countings, people tell how the activity of the solar cycle or how the activity of the sun varies over time. And it seems apparently there is a cycle of 11 years where the sunspots increase over time, and then over 11 years they decrease again. And also the sunspots are magnetic field patches. Of course, it has north and south pole, so it has positive and negative polarity. And then if you look at the northern hemisphere of the sun and the southern hemisphere of the sun, this positive and negative poles are oppositely directed. Like if the positive pole is here and the negative pole is here on the northern hemisphere, it will be reverse in the southern hemisphere. So the physics of it also we know, but this flips the magnetic field of the sun, flips the north pole becomes south pole and the south pole becomes north pole every 11 years, making it a 22-year cycle. So over 22 years, the magnetic field of the sun varies. So that represents the activity of the sun. This being tracked for several decades to centuries. So that we know pretty well. So tracking is not very difficult because we just count what we see, right? So tomorrow we count what we see. But then based on that, how active the sun is, how many flares or how many we call coronal mass ejections, which are eruptions on the sun. So how are these ejections or the massive ejections, how many will be produced or when they will be produced, this physics is being studied. Yeah.
Okay. So, I'm a little bit curious about, since you're talking about this solar activities, mm-hmm. how, so we all know about the solar eclipse, it occurs and then, but how it affects our entire ecosystem of the Earth, this basically eclipse, solar eclipse?
That's a good question again. So most people would know solar eclipse because it's an event that happens quite often, and then people would know from, I think, from centuries that there is an eclipse coming or there is an eclipse next within some time. This the eclipse itself does not last more than few minutes, and then it is confined to certain region on Earth. It's not even like the entire Earth is blocked from the sun or something like that. It happens only a certain belt or certain region on the Earth, and it happens only for a few minutes. So as such, it doesn't have huge impact on the ecosystem, or it doesn't have huge impact on the day-to-day life. Of course, there are certain visual or certain effects which we can see. For example, animals might be thinking it is dark, it is nighttime, or birds might be thinking it is time to go back to their nests, or animals might be sleeping, or like these things might happen. But then that's just because of the amount of light levels fall so much, and it has nothing to do with causing harmful effects on these on human life or animals. Any other life? Yeah.
Actually, if I think you will also be knowing that there are many myths and superstition about the solar eclipse, and many parts of, even in nowadays in our house also. Our parents also will tell if solar eclipse is there, don't go outside. Even if there are a pregnant woman, they are not supposed to go outside. And on that particular period, we will not eat, all the foods will be kept inside. So when someone talk to you like this, and you hear as an astrophysicist, how do you feel? And is there any logic behind this, these myths?
I don't know how it all originated, but then certainly, there might be some motive behind why it has been originated, but then there is no hard truth that it is harmful that if you go outside. What is harmful is that if you look directly at the sun, it is a perhaps an intuitive thing that because the sunlight falls so drastically down, you might look at, I mean, because the sun is usually very bright and you cannot even if you try to look at it, you cannot look at it. Your eyes will automatically close. But then whereas when the light drops so much, when the sun is dark suddenly, you might get tempted to see it directly. So that is one harmful effect, definitely, because if you look at directly, still there is harmful UV radiation and X radiation coming from the sun, and it can damage the sensitive parts of your eye. It can cause permanent damage and you can be blind. You can go blind. So it's not advisable to look directly at the sun. Apart from that, there is no harmful effects of the radiation. Like if you go out, there is nothing new radiation coming. In fact, some part of the radiation is being blocked, not that more radiation is coming. So it's not harmful at all to anyone, whether it is pregnant women or animals or anyone, any life, it's not harmful at all. So it is definitely a superstition. Perhaps, I don't know if old times people might have, this might have originated because you should not look directly at the sun, or maybe that because of that people might ask you to confine to homes or something like that. But there are other religious or other superstitions of, for example, people do puja, or people do, in my home they put a blade of grass, dried certain type of grass in on food or maybe on water, and you have to take a shower after the eclipse is over or something like this. Superstitious beliefs are there. So, but I mean, they don't cause any harm, so I don't care even if they follow in my home or any other places. But going out is actually a good thing during eclipse, because you can witness this beautiful phenomenon happening occasionally in the sky. So you should not look at directly again, I should put this, but you should use protective filters and look at this beautiful phenomenon happening. So if you understand the physics behind it, it's very, very beautiful, because the sun, moon, earth, these all formed because of this gravitational collapse or whatever, but the moon is exactly, the angular size of the moon is exactly same as the sun. What a coincidence it is. Like at certain positions, moon completely blocks the sun just because its angular size is exactly same as the sun. So that's how eclipse comes. It's same thing. Like suppose a plane is going in the sky, you can block it with your finger, like just so you can block the vision of it just with your finger. It's not that plane is the same size as your finger or something, but then it's just the angular size with which you are looking at, that angular size is same just because your finger is too close to you, plane is too far away from you. Similarly, the sun is too far away, even though it is huge compared to earth and moon, it is huge, but it is so far away, whereas the moon is too close by, but the angular sizes exactly coincide. And then when they block each other, the sun is entirely blocked, except the atmosphere, of course.
Great to hear, and great analogy to make us understand people like us. Definitely, I would request viewers to watch this, and maybe their perspective towards solar eclipse will change. So when we were talking about this motion and the location of the sun with respect to the earth, so how do you believe in astrology? Because that is also related to something related to the position of stars or something. So just I'm asking casually, do you believe in the astrology, or is there any logic, scientific logic behind it? Because in India, we many houses, they follow.
Yes, I know. I mean, in many places, other parts of Asia or other parts, maybe some people do believe in astrology, but I don't believe at all, to be honest, in astrology. So it has nothing to do with it. It's no science. It's not at all science. So it's just, based on the positions of planets in the sky, which keep on recurring. It's not a single time phenomenon or something. It keeps on recurring. It's just the time scales might be longer than your lifetime. But then whenever these positions occur, there are several births happening on the earth. So if you're born at this particular position in the planets in the sky, you have certain destination, or you will do something. This is all. I don't believe at all in this. All this. This is all, I feel, nonsense. So I wouldn't believe in all this. Yeah.
Okay. So the question, sir, is regarding now will be the research funding. Because why I am asking this is, basically we are the human, until we any immediate benefits or something, we don't look for the work on that. Because for example, now every country is working towards the developing the weapon, this developing the technology. They see certain benefits, immediate benefits. But in this astrophysics, as we have discussed in initially also, that the impact might be there because of these activity, but not an immediate, maybe 1,000 years, billion years. So how difficult is to get the funding for this kind of research in India, or maybe since you have worked in many countries, so worldwide as well?
It's a good point for us, at least, if not for the viewers. So the funding of the research is quite competitive, which is a good thing. It is competitive, but then at the same time, it will be disappointing to many. So if you don't get the funding, it is quite disappointing, because there is only so much funding. But another interesting point you raised at the beginning is that so the practical applications, like maybe, for example, if you're doing research on, for example, how the wing of a plane can be optimized to make the weight of the plane less, that has more commercial aspects, and then it will be immediately encashed by the industry. So you will perhaps be highly paid, and you will be at the forefront of your research, and it will be very applicative research, and governments will be ready to fund, industries will be ready to fund, anybody will be ready to fund, because it will give you immediate application. Okay. So I would say in research, there are, I might not be correct entirely, but there are, in my view, there are two types of things. One is applicative research, and another is fundamental research. So the fundamental research is good. It is necessary. What you do now as a fundamental research will become applicative research maybe 100 years from the now, or 1,000 years from the now, you never know. But this is very, very essential. Because what is applicative research right now has been fundamental research a while ago, several years ago. Imagine that fundamental research has not been funded or has not been done. Then there is no applicative research now, today. So I can give several examples in day-to-day life. Imagine everyone is moving on the surface of Earth by trains or trams or by buses, and somebody pitched in an idea that we can fly. That might sound ridiculous now. Why would you want to fly? I'm traveling by train. Why would you want to fly, or something like that? That might sound ridiculous, but then once it became practical, this is a bad comparison for me to say that is a fundamental research, because that still had applications we can think of. But maybe I can come up with a better example. See, I can directly talk about astrophysics. The elements, for example, you know, the helium is one of the elements, but then the helium is discovered in the sun. The helium was first discovered in the sun. It was in fact discovered in India, in Andhra Pradesh, some parts of Andhra Pradesh, during an eclipse observation. So the helium was discovered on the sun. So why is it important? Because there are several, once you know the periodic table, you know the elements, what element is different from other element. It has obviously industrial applications, right? Well, once you know for example, if you know copper, it's a good conductor, or something like some other element, it's useful for this, for maybe magnetic, paramagnetic material, or it is useful to make magnets or something like that. So there are several practical applications by knowing these elements. Some of the elements are discovered by doing astrophysical research, but when the research was done to discover the helium, it was not aimed at any applicative research. Right? It was not aimed at any industrial applications. It was just an observation of the sun. So they were observing the sun, and they accidentally find a spectral line, which was weird. And why is this weird? They investigated, and that investigations went on for maybe more than a decade, I guess. So, and then ultimately they found out this is a helium. So this is just an element. Even then they didn't have any practical applications, right? It's just a helium. But then slowly, as the research goes on, as we know more and more, then the applications will become evident. So the fundamental research is very, very essential to have applicative research in the future. So this is what any country should recognize. And then if you see the fundamental research, all the developed nations will fund the fundamental research quite good, still less than applicative research or the industrial research, but they fund quite better than maybe in India or somewhere else. This fundamental, it is up to the governments to recognize that fundamental research is important. Of course, during certain emergencies, you might think, oh, this, we don't have immediate application, so we can stop funding for now. But then on a long run, it should not be stopped for any country or any government. Or in fact, if I would speak for the entire world or humankind, the fundamental research is very, very essential to progress in the future, even though it doesn't have any practical applications right immediately after.
Maybe the fundamental research, like, we might not be able to redeem immediate basis, but there is a huge impact in the future.
Yes, it can have huge impacts anytime. You never know, because that has not been envisioned. We don't even know what is going to unravel or what is going to unwrap. So unless you do the research and find out something, so even when you are doing it, you wouldn't know the applications of it until you understand it completely and then try to make applications out of it. There has been several examples in the past in the history that like I said, helium is one of the elements we discovered, or there are several things that came out of astrophysics, but not just astrophysics, even the basic physics. For example, understanding an electron revolves around proton, or the nucleus has so many components. What is the point of it? So nucleus has so many components. We wouldn't be, there are certain forces within the core of the nucleus of an atom, for example. People study, investigate, lots of money, lots of computer resources, lots of researchers work on it, but then they don't have immediate practical applications. But then once they make a discovery, once they make something big, that can immediately open up entire new paradigm or entire new thing for us in the future. So that you would never know. So that's why fundamental research is very, very important.
Thanks for explaining. Actually, for me, the only research was the topic, but now you have well differentiated between what is a fundamental and what is a need, and then applicative research. That's quite good. Mm-hmm. Now, actually, I was seeing also this about the NASA Parker Solar Probe mission. So would you be able to tell something about this?
Yes, I can. I can tell. It's very, very exciting and interesting mission. So it basically flies towards the sun. So it goes very close to the sun. That's one of the very interesting and exciting missions that has been launched recently that is related to the solar physics, or that is related to the sun. So they use the mission, the satellite itself goes pretty close to the sun. How much close to say is it goes as much close as 4% of the distance between the sun and earth. So the distance between sun and earth is about 150 million kilometers, and it goes as close as like maybe 10 million kilometers or maybe 8 million kilometers or something like that. So it goes very close, 4 to 5% of the distance between the sun. So it means it is traveling 96% of the distance from the earth towards the sun. So of course, it's not a direct path, because ultimately all the objects revolve around the sun. So the satellite also has this path rotating around the sun, and this 4% of the distance, what we call, is the closest point, which we call perihelion of the orbit. So I mean, you don't have to know the technical details, but that is the closest point if you imagine a ecliptic orbit around the sun. So there will be one closest point to the epicenter, and there will be farthest point. So the closest point is about 4% of the distance, but it's going year by year, it is going closer and closer to the sun. So that is the closest approach is about 4% of the distance. And we are excited about it
it because no man-made mission has ever been that close to the sun. So there are certain elements which we can observe from here, but if we go that close to the sun, we can even do so-called in situ measurements, which means that the local measurements, you can do locally how the particles are behaving, how the magnetic fields are behaving, for example, or something like that. If we can measure that locally, and also by taking pictures or images, which we call remote sensing, because you just take a picture of something away from you. So that is called remote sensing. And then you you also capture locally what is happening. So these are all very important elements, because nothing, no man-made satellite or nothing has ever gone so close to the sun.
So I have one question. How closely are you related to this?
Sorry, I forgot to put the headset on. Yeah, yes.
No, my point was that how closely are you to this mission?
My research has, no direct connection, in the sense that I don't use the data of the Parker Solar Probe as of now, but I'm free to do, if I want, I'm free to do that research as well. But I don't, the research I'm currently doing is not directly connected to that, but the outcome of the Parker Solar Probe will be useful for my research, because what it is going to discover, we don't know yet, but whatever it is going to discover, it is going to improve the science of the sun. It is going to give us extra information of the sun that we haven't been so far able to understand. So if that information is available, that is definitely going to push the entire solar physics by a leap. So, and that will be useful for us in the future. Maybe that's useful for my research too, as it is for any other solar physicist or any other person, any other astrophysicist.
What is the time lag between the information gathered by NASA or ISRO for that matter and coming to the research institutes like the one you are working for?
It depends on the satellite, actually. See, there are most satellites orbit close to Earth. They orbit around the Earth, right? So they, if they are very close, then we have certain ground stations. So to receive the satellite communications, you need these ground stations with big dish antennas, which will receive the communication, right? So we have certain ground stations at different parts of the world, different parts of the globe, so that we can continuously receive the communication whenever the satellite passes through that particular point on the surface of the Earth, above the surface of the Earth. So the satellites which rotate around the Earth, we can pretty much get immediately the information. In the sense that especially the solar images, you can get within few hours maybe, and that few hours is only not the latency because of there is a time gap between the transmission, but the latency because of you need to process a bit to make it presentable to the general community or even to the scientific researchers. So you have to do certain bit of corrections, elementary corrections. All that will be done automatically by computers, but then to make it presentable, and there is also a certain bit of latency by the satellite to pass the data to the local ground stations. And from there it goes to the servers, and then from there it goes to the public. So it will take, there is a bit of latency, but you see directly on the website. There are certain web links for the sun.
Oh, great. So this, see, if we see most of the time, and actually in worldwide, we will be talking about the NASA's missions or anything. So what is your thought about Indian organization, this ISRO? And actually I was reading about this, and then we came to know that even India is planning for a mission to solar, that is Aditya L1, I guess, right?
Yes, yeah, that's correct.
Yeah, so would you tell us something about this?
Oh yes, so ISRO is the Indian Space Research Organization. So that is the counterpart of what NASA is for America. So the ISRO is for India. So obviously ISRO does a wide, diversified research going on, mostly concerned about launching these space satellites or space missions for India or even for other countries. So coming to Aditya L1 is the is going to be the first ever solar mission from India. So which means there are exciting times in the near future for Indian solar community or for the global solar community for that matter. So this Aditya L1, like I said, I mean NASA, and then there is a European, less known European space agency called ESA. So and then there is Japanese space agency called JAXA. So there are other space agencies as well. They all launched, not they all, I think NASA, ESA in collaboration, they launched several solar missions before. So they have been, they are well ahead to ISRO, but then this is a very good, we are a young nation, and this is a very good first step for us that we are going to launch this first ever solar mission soon. It will happen early next year, first quarter of next year, I would imagine, as far as the current status goes. And once that happens, it might take a few months before it goes to the scientific phase. And then once it goes to the scientific phase, it starts observing, and then the data will be soon available to the community and to the public as well. And then we start working on it. So it has a unique, I mean, each satellite mission has either one instrument or multiple instruments. This Aditya has multiple instruments. It has about seven payloads, which we call, or payloads are different instruments doing different things. Like some of them observe, like I said, a while before in situ, which means the locally what is happening. They measure some of the things locally. Some of the instruments take the pictures, or the remote sensing instruments, which take remotely the state of the sun. They capture the state of the sun. There are certain unique elements of Aditya L1 compared to other missions that has been launched by NASA or other things, but those are a bit technical details, so I wouldn't go into that. But one aspect is that this is also challenging for ISRO or to India, because this is the first mission, or I would say, yeah, I think it is the first mission that is going to the, there is a point called L1. So this L1 means the Lagrange point where the gravity of the Earth and the Sun balances. So there is a point between the Sun and Earth, which is about 1.5 million kilometers away from the Earth. So that at that point, the gravity from the pull force from the Sun and the Earth balances. So which means that is a stable point. At this point, I mean, around that point, this satellite rotates, so revolves. I can say around that point, this satellite revolves. So once, because that is a stable point, the reason, the importance of that point is that as Earth moves around the sun, that point also moves. So which means the spacecraft has a constant eye on the sun. So it will be continuously seeing the sun. Whereas if it is a Earth rotating satellite, so most of the Earth rotating satellites are polar satellites in the sense that they go around the poles or close to the poles at certain inclination to the equator. So if they're polar satellites, what happens is certain amount of time it spends behind the Earth, so which means it cannot see the sun. So whereas this being close to the, I mean, this being between a point between sun and Earth, and it rotates around the sun like the Earth rotates at the point. So Earth revolves, it should be revolution to be scientifically correct. So that revolution means that it has a constant vision of the sun. So this is also a challenge because I think ISRO has never launched a satellite to go that far. So as far as I know, I think I'm correct, mostly correct. Yeah.
Oh, so that is how they put the name Aditya L1.
Yes, that's how the name came, Aditya L1. Initially, the mission was slated to be like a Earth rotating satellite. So that time it was just Aditya, simply Aditya. And then now they call Aditya L1. Mm-hmm. because later they changed the plan to move to the L1 point, because you will have extra information, and apart from continuous vision of the sun, there are also other scientific benefits. So
So I'll come again to that funding point. Because since India is a developing nation, so of course I would like to understand the application and what input we will be getting as a country. Means the scientist has convinced the government to launch this mission. So what is the input we will be getting? How what would be the application in near term? Where it will put us in the world as a country?
So see, there are certain unique elements of Aditya, but like you said, what is the immediate application or immediate use of it? So the obviously this is a constant question we keep on getting whenever we put our applications for funding, or this is a constant question anybody would ask, why do you want this, what will you do with this research, or something like that. But most of the, there is a certain element of, use, in the sense that we discussed the potential impacts of these huge explosions that happen on the sun. So we should be, part of the satellite will be investigating that. These huge explosions coming from the sun, the part of the satellite will be investigating, researching on how these explosions happen. And then how they, at what time these arrive. So that is the application bit of it, or the immediate use bit of it, for putting us in the forefront. But there are other satellites doing that as well. But Aditya has other scientific benefits. Like I said, it has a, I'm trying not to go into too technical terms, but it has something called visible, it absorbs invisible emission lines. So, which means, see, most of the satellites need to go to space, because the EUV, or the extreme ultraviolet radiation or X-ray radiation, doesn't reach to the surface of the Earth. It gets blocked by the atmosphere. So you need to go out the atmosphere to see that radiation. And when you see that radiation, you see the sun in other wavelengths. So you get a different perspective. You get more, you get to understand better. Whereas Aditya, one of the instruments on Aditya L1 observes invisible emission lines. There are, scientific advantages in observing that. But this is one of the unique satellites that is going to observe the sun in these emission lines with a number of spectrographic slits. So I'm trying a balance between not to be too technical, but it has trust me that it has a certain unique abilities that is going to put us at the forefront of the world global research. So immediate benefits include, like I said, about the coronal mass ejections. That is one of the main goals of Aditya, to understand these coronal mass ejections, the science behind these coronal mass ejections.
I see. So, Krishna, everything comes to an end. So will the sun. So my question is, how will it end? Like a super, it will become a supernova, or I think a dwarf star, or just like a black hole. And have we ever calculated the age of the sun, or not the age of the sun, the time the sun will last, the fuel of the sun will last?
Of course, we know the... we know the mass of the sun, we know the material, amount of hydrogen, amount of helium inside the sun. We know the physical process by which it is burning the fuel. So we know pretty much what is happening in the core of the sun. So we can estimate by when the fuel will get exhausted, or the sun will get burned out, and then overall the total age of the sun or something. So it's roughly about 10 billion years is the overall age. And then out of which we are already, nearly the Earth formed, or the solar system formed, about 4.6 billion years ago, which means we are nearly halfway, and then there is 5 more billion years to go. So it is in the halfway, And once the hydrogen fuel burns out, what happens is sun goes into a phase called red giant phase. It expands. The outer layer of the sun expands pretty much. It expands to huge distances and it becomes red. The reason is as it expands, it cools down. So it goes to lower or the longer wavelengths. So it gets from white to red. So it goes, so that's called red giant phase. It becomes a giant and it becomes red. So that's called red giant phase, as the name suggests. And after the inside material or the core of the sun that gets collapses, that gets further collapsed. And then it forms, after a while, the outer shell gets expelled and then there will be a core left, which that phase is called white dwarf. So every star goes through this process, but then whether a star ends up as a white dwarf or whether a star becomes a supernova or a black hole, that depends on the mass of the initial mass of the star. So from the initial mass of the sun, it is determined that it will end up as a white dwarf. If there is a star which is massive than the sun, there are like millions or billions of stars massive than the sun. So if there are stars which are massive than the sun, those stars can end up in supernova, and if it is even more massier, then it might end up in black hole, end up as a black hole.
I see. I don't know how I forget to ask it, but how did the sun actually made from the start after Big Bang? How did the sun or any star, how does it become a star?
Yes. See, this is all we learned during early stages of our introduction to astrophysics, how the stars actually form, or the life cycle of stars, which we call stellar evolution. Sun is obviously, it's just a star. It's unique to us, it's special to us, but it's one of the stars which we see. If we were at the other star, that star might be unique to us, but sun will be just another star. So the advantage of sun is that we look at, as a result, other stars look just like a point in the sky, whereas sun, we see the surface of the sun. So we look at the resolved elements of the sun. So that's an extra benefit, because sun is just another star, which sounds boring, but it is also beneficial, because by studying sun, you're studying other stars as well. You're getting information on other stars as well, because it's no special star. So you're studying sun and then you're getting knowledge on other stars as well by studying the resolved elements of the sun. So coming back to, you said how these stars form. So all the stars form by so-called gravitational collapse. So what happens is that the life cycle of star goes like this. There is a huge material, huge cloud of hydrogen hanging around in space. This cloud of hydrogen, once it becomes massive enough, because of self-gravity, it collapses. And as it collapses, the hydrogen comes close, the hydrogen atoms comes closer and closer and closer and closer. Because of gravity, it keeps on collapsing. And when the hydrogen atoms become enough closer, there will be nuclear fusion, fusing two hydrogen atoms forming helium. In the process, it releases energy. This energy balances the gravitational force. So once it reaches a certain stable state, the hydrogen keeps burning, keep pushing the matter away from collapsing further. So then there is a balanced ball of gas called star. Balanced ball of gas burning, that is called star. So that's how stars are formed. Of course, like I said, the other part of the story is that these stars, as the fuel burns out, the star expands and explodes. And then, so once this star explodes, all the material again goes back into space, right? So this material goes back into space and then accumulates somewhere. And once it reaches a certain threshold mass, again, it forms a star. This is the life cycle of stars.
It's so amazing that by chance, we get the right mass of the sun. By chance, we get the right mass of Earth at the right place. And then everything got out of it. And but by chance also, now there is a lot of talk about UFOs, or now they are calling it UAP. Mm-hmm. And after the Pentagon release and the New York Times article, I think I have started to believe in UFOs. And the people like Jeremy Corbell or George Knapp, they are doing a lot of work. And I said, I listen to a lot of podcasts, and there many people are there who are following this UFO story. Mm-hmm. As an astrophysicist, what is your thought process about it?
See, if you look at the sky, if you look at the sky, certainly there will be certain elements which you cannot explain. So as a community, if I look at the sky, there will be, I mean, there are certain objects moving or certain things happening, and then I cannot explain. I can think this as unidentified something flying object. See, part of this comes from the fact that we are not unique. So in the sense that, like I said, a while before, Sun is just another star. So which means there are billions of stars in the sky. So other stars could also have planets around them. In fact, they do. And we do know that other stars have planets around them. So if they have planets around them, there will be a certain planet which will have similar atmospheric conditions or the physical conditions as we have on Earth, which means the life is sustainable there too. Which means there is a very high chance, if you have billions of stars, why is it so unique that we have life here but not at some other star? There is a very good chance that there is life at other planets too, other stars too. It's just that we are not able to communicate to each other, we are not able to reach each other or something like that. So maybe we are not advanced enough, maybe they are advanced enough, and they might be coming here using certain technology, or this knowledge makes us believe that, okay, if we see something unidentified object, then we can say, oh, then that might be something aliens or the other extraterrestrial beings coming here. So I'm not denying that that's not a possibility. If there is a life, they can be certainly advanced, much advanced than us, or maybe much primitive than us. So if they are advanced life, they might be trying to travel or communicate to us. But what I believe is, if they are already here, and if they are advanced, they are using advanced technology than us, they would find a way to communicate, or they would find a way to do some things the way which we know, rather than keeping silent. So I wouldn't I wouldn't deny seeing people seeing some unidentified objects in the sky, but I wouldn't accept them as extraterrestrial objects or something like that.
See, whenever we go to office now, obviously because of lockdown, we are not going so frequently, but during the canteen time or lunch time, I mean in canteen, we used to talk about this type of stuff because it's just entertaining and what should I say, also enriching something, brain is working. Do you also do that in your canteen, talk about this type of stuff, or you just go away from cosmos altogether?
No, we talk about all kind of things, from like from politics to from different things happening in news. So we talk about all types of things during our coffee times, or whenever we meet casually chatting with each other. Nowadays we talk about vaccine or the pandemic, or maybe the politics happening around the world, or things like this. We do talk about all these things. So these are exciting things for us too. For example, like you said, these UFOs now also called UAPs. So it would be embarrassing for me not to know what a UAP is. But of course, I mean, I might not be following the news, and then, okay, I don't know. But so it is unidentified aerial phenomena, now they call. But I mean, these are all the things we follow the news and we discuss as well. So it's not, we perhaps understand a bit better because we have more knowledge on it and we work on it. So we perhaps understand a bit better. But at the same time, how the it's like the how the education path goes. When you're a kid, you study all the social sciences, history, geography, or the sciences, mathematics, or all the things. But when you grow bigger and bigger, you take specializations, and you're only specialized in that. Now, if I ask you about history or law or geography or something, you might say, oh, I don't know, I don't have much knowledge on it. Similarly, in research, the more we grow, the more focused we become. And I might be doing research only few people in the community or the global community might be very well aware of it. But at the same time, if you ask me broadly the bigger picture, I will have to Google myself and I'll have to find out to answer you. So I will not be having complete knowledge on the broader, bigger picture. So I might have some knowledge and I might understand it better if I dig deeper, but at the same time, if you ask me suddenly, I might not know it. So I might not, I might never have heard of it. So that's how things go.
I see. As I was saying at the start that I'm so happy that an astrophysicist is at my podcast, but as you might also know that there are many famous astrophysicists who are, what should I say, are entertaining people as well as imparting information and some knowledge, like Neil deGrasse Tyson. I mean, he is a well-known celebrity physicist. So do you think that someday we will have that in India, or is there already someone in India who normal people like me do not know? And when are you becoming the next Neil deGrasse Tyson of India?
See, honestly speaking, I don't know much about him, but I know that he's a science communicator or something like that. So communication of science to general public is extremely important, because the general people should understand the importance of it. Only then, like we discussed several questions during our chat for the past 1 hour or so about fundamental research, applicative research, why is it important? Why should we fund you, or why should you get money, or something like that? All these things public should be aware of. It not only brings people into science or this fundamental research, it also makes people aware of the fact that it is important. This research is important. So the science communication is very important. Like I said, it's part of our, we should make it part of our job. But at the same time, some people might be, might make that as the bigger part because they're too passionate about it. So some people might take research as more passionate. So it all depends on the individual. So I personally, I'm happy to communicate to general public, but I don't want to make that as my main theme of my future career. I certainly want to be connected to the research. At the same time, I want to communicate to the people, but not, I don't want to make one as the theme or the other. Regarding speaking, excellent public communicators, there are certainly several excellent public communicators in India, but not as famous as the Neil D. Tyson or something. There are good communicators in India as well. So I think in future, obviously, we might get someone, you never know. There are several amateur astronomers, in India, who knows much better than me, despite being an astrophysicist, who knows the position of the stars, certain stars, and then they can say, okay, this is this particular star. I cannot even talk about which star it is, or even that is a star or a planet if I look into the sky. But certain amateur astronomers know much, much better than me or some of other astrophysicists. So people have different kind of knowledge, different kind of information, and people are interested in different things, which is good.
So Krishna, I would like you to tell to our viewers or young viewers, what are the institute in India and any information for the young people who want to pursue their career in astrophysics?
I will take this opportunity to tell about several research institutes in India. Because when I was coming, it was by accident, like I said, and then I was not aware of information much ahead in my life about all these institutes. So it's a good opportunity to communicate to your viewers or the general public about several research institutes in India. So there are, some of them related to astrophysics, I will point out, but there are much more institutes nowadays. So one of it is Indian Institute of Astrophysics in Bangalore, where I did my PhD from. There is also Inter-University Center for Astronomy and Astrophysics in Pune, which is called IUCA in short. So that is in Pune. There is also Tata Institute of Fundamental Research in Mumbai. And then there is also Aryabhatta Research Institute in Nainital. There is also Physical Research Laboratory in Ahmedabad. And then there is Vikram Sarabhai Space Center in Trivandrum. And then there is also S.N. Bose Institute in Kolkata or something like that. S.N. Bose Institute. So there are several research institutes. There are Institute of Plasma Research, Plasma Physics Research in Gandhinagar, Gujarat or something like that. There are several research institutes. Apart from these, I mean, I'm talking about only those institutes where my research related things are present at the moment, but then there are several research institutes. And these are only research institutes, but there are nowadays, even in universities and IITs, the astronomy and astrophysics is coming. When one of the premier research institutes where my field solar physics is being actively pursued is IIT BHU, Varanasi. So the IIT Banaras Hindu University in Varanasi, their solar physics is being actively pursued. Astrophysics is also there in certain other IITs. I'm not entirely sure about them, but then if you, I mean, I can pursue the links and perhaps give it to you so that you can post along with the video, but there are many, many research institutes, universities and IITs who are slowly expanding to astrophysics.
In the same question, I would add one more point is regarding the like job career. At least I would not say that, okay, after astrophysics, you will be getting so much, but can you guide them? What kind of job and which are the institute, or is there any private institute where they can get any certain fundings or kind of job basically? And in India, most of the time, when you have, even you are interested and you have to convince your parents, first you have to convince them after doing 5 year or 10 year of studies, okay, you will be getting some money and you can live. So if you can tell us something about that.
Yeah, certainly, yes. So see, funding wise or the money you will be getting wise in the future, I would say, it might not be as much as your friends or colleagues in other streams might get, for example, in IT industry or other industries, where they might be getting much more than what you would get being in academia. But then there are other, several other benefits. People have their own motivations why they want to do in research. But first I will talk about the career path. So, the way I was introduced is by doing a project, research project during my master's. But master's is not the only way. Certain research institutes accept even if you did engineering, but in certain streams, maybe in optical engineering or mechanical engineering or certain other streams, they are useful for astronomy too. So if you do certain other streams, computer science, I think I'll have to dig the exact information, but the computer science or the mechanical engineering or the optical or electronics engineering, all these are useful streams to get into astronomy. So certain institutes might accept certain streams, they might not accept other streams depending on their requirement, but you should check the requirement of each institute. So either after engineering or the bachelor's or master's, you can get into PhD. So after PhD, the next path, the general path, is that you will do something called postdoctoral position, which is an intermediate position before you're getting a permanent job as an assistant professor or associate professor. So after this intermediate position of postdoctoral position, during which you will be gaining more research experience after your PhD. Throughout the time, I think right from the PhD after your master's, you will start earning. Like I said, it will not be as much as your colleagues or your friends in other streams might be earning, but there are other perks. Perks in the sense that in India, for example, I can talk about when I was doing my PhD, all my medical bills are covered. In the I'll have a separate insurance, health insurance, with all my medical bills are covered. I was getting a quarters to live, and I was getting subsidized food. I will also get travel allowances, in the sense that not my personal travel, but work related travel. And I got to travel to several countries as part of my research work, to present my work or to interact with other scientists across the globe. I got to travel to several countries. Other perks include like, I mean, for me, one of the motivations is that I do what I want to do. Like, I, it's not that I'm working towards certain goal of a multinational company to give them certain output at the end of the day and then giving them, ultimately working towards their goals, right? Each individual employee will be working towards the goals of the company, goals of a certain project defined by a multinational company or something. But then here, I work purely based on my curiosity. I work like, okay, I want to understand this. This is very interesting thing happening on the sun, or this is very interesting thing happening somewhere in some other place. I want to find out the physical reason behind this. So that curiosity drives me mostly, but people have different motivations. So I wouldn't put money as one of them, but because you wouldn't be getting too much compared to your other friends, but there are certain perks. And once you get a permanent position, you will be a central government employee, or then the benefits of being a central government employee will also come into effect. So yeah, there are definitely much more perks.
Okay, so any plan to publish a book or any suggestion for the general information where people like us can understand?
Publishing a book is, I mean, at my career stage, it's perhaps too big a thing for me. Maybe at a later stage of my career, I would anticipate, like, if I'm doing really good in the future of my career, maybe I can publish a book, but not at the moment with my current knowledge. Perhaps I'm not that accomplished enough to publish a book for general public. What is the other part of your question? Sorry.
No, any suggestion or any book which contains general information which is understandable for people like us?
For general information astrophysics, so I have to dig into this bit and then find some books. Maybe I'll send you the links and then you can post it along with the video. I'll try to find that out. But I mean, I can recommend one book which I studied just before my PhD to get into solar physics. So there was a book called Journey from the Center of the Earth to the Sun, or something like that. So Journey from the Center of the Earth to the Sun, or Center of the Sun to the Earth, or something like that. So that was written by perhaps an American astronomer. I'm not entirely sure, but the name of the author is Jack B. Zirker, Z-I-R-K-E-R. So Jack B. Zirker. So that was the name of the author of that book, and that was very, very elementary. So that I found the problems of the solar physics, I got introduced to the problems of the solar physics through that book. That was very, very elementary to me when I read that book, and I found it very, very interesting. So maybe I'm not sure, it depends on your background. It might sound technical, but
The book's name is Journey from the Center of the Sun.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you were right. It's from Jack B. Zirker. Jack B. Z-I-R-K-E-R. So,
yes. Yeah. So that's one interesting book I read, during the early days of my career. But there can be other general astrophysics books for sure for general public. So I'll try to find out if there are any interesting books, and then I'll try to give you the links. Yeah.
I see. So tell us, what's your plan for future? Are you moving on to another celestial bodies in future, or you want to stick to sun for a while?
Moving is, at the moment, I'm not planning to move to other celestial bodies, because it involves, obviously, my experience and my research experience in this stream has been like for several, more than 10 years, I have been working on this particular particular field. I can certainly move to other field in the future. I mean, at the moment I have no plans, but I should, as they say, never say never. So I don't know, maybe in the future I might move, but at the moment I certainly don't have any plans to move.
As I said, we are stupid people. We don't know anything about it. Is it very difficult to move to another celestial bodies for research?
It's like definitely it is not easy, because when you move to at this experience level, if I move to other celestial bodies or other parts of astrophysical research or other research topic, then I have to start from the ground. I have to again start from the beginning and then try to understand all the things. It might be a bit easier than it would be for me if I were 10 years younger, but because I have certain amount of broad knowledge, so it might be a bit easier, but not very easy. It would again take several years to come to this level of experience in other stream. So yeah, it would take some time.
So what are your plans in the future for the Sun, at least right now?
I mean, I would continue the research which I'm doing, as we discussed before. I would continue the research, but if there is something interesting comes up in the future, I might consider moving. But I would continue working on this. My research is very much related to this coronal heating problem, so I would continue working on that.
Do you have some unanswered question which is yet to be found out right now, and it doesn't allow you to, I mean, not literally, but doesn't allow you to sleep at night? Is there any question which is unanswered?
That would be, I mean, there are, we get these questions now and then as part of our research, but then those things would be too technical to discuss. But I mean, broadly speaking, in astrophysics, there are many more questions which are unexplored, which we don't know yet. I mean, to be understandable to general public, we know that all the Big Bang or the universe started from a point, and then universe is still expanding. It started with a big explosion and it is continuously expanding. And the people ask, the space and time starts from there. So there are certain elements which would be very less imaginative or less very difficult to understand. Like, what happens if you ask before, what happens before Big Bang? But there is no concept of time before Big Bang. So it is absurd to discuss before Big Bang. But then if you don't discuss, then it should start at certain point of time, that is zero. That is a certain point of time. So these questions, and then there is also universe, the known matter or the visible matter which we know is just less than 5% of the entire universe. So there is a so-called dark energy and dark matter, which is about like more than 90% of the universe, which we don't understand, which we don't have no clue of. So these are all open questions in astrophysics. Like I said, in Sun, there is an open question related to coronal heating problem. There are also other questions like I said, the Sun has this magnetic cycle of 22 years or something, but this magnetic field gets amplified and then again de-amplified or something like that, and then again get amplified, but then it scales down and then gets amplified, but where is this it getting this magnetic field from? So there is a so-called process called dynamo, which we don't completely understand yet. So this occurs in all the other stars too, and many more research problems in astrophysics are very, very elementary and which we don't understand. So research is going on all these topics. So if people will go deep into this, there are many interesting problems that one can catch hold of and then try to explore them.
So great. I mean, it was great knowing everything, whatever you told. And I'm pretty sure that I will be listening to this podcast maybe 5 more times to get into everything what you said, because my mind cannot understand everything. And then I have to go and again and again and to understand everything. And probably we would request you to come back to our podcast and give us some more information. Maybe we will pick another research podcast thing and then we will talk about that only. But do you have anything to say to our viewers today?
Sure. As I said in the beginning, it is my pleasure to be on this channel, and it is my pleasure to be discussing this with you. I enjoyed quite a lot, because I also would like to see the perspective of general public, like what you think of different topics, or what questions crops up into your mind. And then, so it was very good conversation overall. I enjoyed it throughout the time. I did not even realize the time so far. So I would definitely consider coming back again in the future whenever that opportunity comes. And then this is very interesting for me too. And if it helps any of your viewers to understand even a iota of solar physics or iota of astrophysics, and it, if it motivates people to get into astrophysics or solar physics, I would be a blessed soul or pleased soul.
So do we. That is our main target for this podcast. And thank you very much once again for coming to this podcast. And I know Abhimanyu will say the same, that we enjoyed it more than you, because for you it's your daily activity. For us it's like a fresh burst of wind which gave us very much so much of new information. And I think we should close this podcast now. Thank you everyone who is watching, and like, share and subscribe our channel, share and subscribe our channel, and help us grow this ecosystem. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you very much.
Check the mic and make sure it sound right, boys.